pray for God's help. Father God, this preaching now requires gravity and warmth. Much gravity from the serious nature of the subject matter, and sweet warmth from the beloved nature of the people who are assembled here. Oh God, in this moment, unite this gravity and warmth in the unction, the unmistakable unction that comes only from your Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There were a dozen donuts, pink, with sprinkles on them, if you must know. A pecan Pringle, a pecan Kringle, and a little box of those mini cinnamon rolls. And we went through all of them. I was with about 26, 27 people yesterday in that room right over there. And we had 3 or 4 hours where we went through the church membership class. And in that class, we went through the doctrine, the direction, the ministries of RBC. And the one thing that those people that were assembled kept hearing me say over the hours that we went through that material together was, look, it doesn't really matter what I say. It doesn't really matter who the pastors are at RBC. It doesn't really matter this or that. The only thing that matters is what has Jesus said in his word. And even as we talked about eldership and leadership and everything else about the church, what those folks kept hearing me say was, the only leader who really matters is that this is a church of which Jesus Christ is the head. He's the one that we follow, and he's the one that it's all about. And this morning, I find myself wanting to emphasize to all of you as an introduction to the book of Hebrews, the same thing that I was emphasizing yesterday in that church membership class, that it really is all about Jesus. This is the second week in our introduction to the book of Hebrews, and I want to acquaint you with kind of what the book is and what's in it. And so in order to do that, I just want to take you this morning into three passages that explain to us who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. So each of these three passages shows us who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. But these passages aren't going to be shared with you, and the book of Hebrews wasn't written for us by the Holy Spirit merely for information, so we could sort of know who Jesus is and know what Jesus has done. The book of Hebrews was written to grab a hold of us and rescue us from drowning and sinking. The book of Hebrews was written to rescue us. So each of these three passages not only shows you who Jesus is, but I'm telling you, each one of these three passages will show you who you are now because of who Jesus is. And each of these three passages will not only show you what Jesus has done, but each one of these passages will show you what you are called to do today and tomorrow. What you are called to do today and tomorrow because of what Jesus has done. So the three passages are Hebrews 1, verses 1 through 3, Hebrews 2, verses 14 to 18, and then Hebrews 9, verses 23 to 27. Let's start in Hebrews 1, verses 1 through 3. This shows us who Jesus is and what Jesus has done, as it shows us who we are and what we're called to do. Hebrews 1, verse 1. Long ago, at many times and in many ways, God spoke to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, through whom also he created the world. He is, verse 3, Jesus is, verse 3, he is, Jesus is,
the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature, and he upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. Each of the relative clauses that follow the phrase he is, or that follow the phrase God has spoken to us by his Son, each of the phrases that follow set forth these facts about who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. But they're not facts merely for our mental information. They're meant for our present rescue, so that we know who we are because of who Jesus is, and we know what we can do now because of what Jesus has done. They're meant to help us to hold on to Jesus' supremacy, and they're meant to help us experience what it means to be saved by Jesus. So these verses really are a mouthful. Let me break it down for you in four, hopefully simple, understandable points. Number one, the essential identity of Jesus. The essential identity of Jesus is given to us there in verse 3a. He is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. That the essential identity of Jesus is that he is divine. He maintains within himself the very nature of God. That's his essential identity. Number two, these show us Jesus' essential power. The essential power of Jesus. Because it says there, going on in verse 3, not only is his identity the radiance of his glory and the exact imprint of his nature, but it says he upholds the universe by the word of his power. This shows us the essential power of Jesus. And the power of Jesus is that he upholds everything without ever growing weary or tired. The essential, eternal, unending, unlimited power of Jesus. The third is the essential mission of Jesus. And this is where our needs are met. This is in the wonderful phrase that follows next in verse 3. Not only does he uphold the universe by the word of his power, but look what it says. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand. After making purification for sins. That word purification that's used there in verse 3 is a priestly word. It comes from the book of Leviticus. And one of the things that the book of Hebrews is going to do is take all of this bloody, priestly, sacrificial language of Leviticus and show that it was all pointing to this one perfect sacrifice. The essential mission of Jesus, that he purified us from our sins. That's the third point. And then the fourth point in this verse is the essential reward. The essential reward that Jesus has received. And you see that in the end of verse 3, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. And you can even see it in the very first phrase in the last phrase in verse 2, whom he appointed the heir of all things. Jesus is the heir of all things, and he is seated on the throne at the right hand of the Majesty on high. This is his reward for faithfully and sufficiently saving us. So all these things about Jesus, his essential identity, his essential power, his essential reward. The thing is, we could talk about who Jesus is, and I hate to even think about it, but we could talk about who Jesus is in a way that didn't even help us at all. This is why it all comes back down to that third point, his essential mission. That he has purified us from our sins, that his blood has washed our sin away, that his body was broken for us, that our bodies might be saved. The point is, Jesus has done this, and it is of such worth to us and such value to us because now we can be saved. The wonder behind that little phrase that after making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God. The wonder of it is simply this, that this table that represents salvation, that represents welcome into the household of God, this table is a table that none of us is worthy to eat at. And yet, because Jesus died, because purification has been made, God now says to us with no hesitation and no contradiction, God says to us, come and welcome. You belong at this table. If our sins were still on us, we would deserve to be incinerated. But because our sins were placed on Jesus, now we are invited. We are invited into fellowship with God because Jesus died, Jesus rose, because Jesus became flesh and blood, bread and wine for us. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free, is even counted justified without sin, right with God. Because he has purified us. So the whole point of this first place that we drop into Hebrews to show us who Jesus is, if you want to summarize point one, you could summarize this first passage this way. Jesus is the one who forgives fully. Jesus is the one who forgives fully. That he purified us from our sins, and this is so full and so complete that he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on God. Jesus is the one who forgives us fully. And as I said, we're not just talking about who Jesus is, but now we can see who we are if we see who Jesus is. So the completion of point one from this passage is Jesus is the one who forgives fully. I am forgiven and free forever. This is the assurance that we can have. I am forgiven and free forever. Who Jesus is and who I am. Jesus is the one who forgives fully. I am forgiven and free forever. If he's my Savior and I'm trusting not in my own righteousness or not in the blood of lambs and goats and bulls and religious observances, but I'm trusting in Jesus Christ. Jesus is the one who forgives fully. I am forgiven and free forever. Second passage, Hebrews 2, verses 14 through 18, to serve as an introduction to who Jesus is and who we are and what the book of Hebrews teaches about Jesus. Second passage is Hebrews 2. In our first passage in Hebrews 1, this is one of the reasons why the book of Hebrews is so amazing. We have one of the highest expressions of the deity of Christ, that he's the exact imprint of the divine nature. And here in Hebrews 2, we have one of the most amazing statements of the absolute and full humanity of Jesus Christ. Hebrews 2, verses 14 through 18. Hebrews 2:14, since therefore the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise partook of the same things, that through death he might destroy the one who has the power of death, that is the devil, and deliver all those who through fear of death were subject to lifelong slavery. For surely it is not angels that he helps, but he helps the offspring of Abraham, humanity. Therefore, he had to be made like his brothers in every respect so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For because he himself has suffered when tempted, he is able to help those who are being tempted. This is an astonishing set of verses here. Look at verse 17. He had to be made like his brothers in every respect. Verse 17 says, Jesus was made this way. He was made like his brothers. Verse 17 says, Jesus was made this way. Verse 18 completes the thought. Verse 17 says, Jesus was made this way. Verse 18 completes the thought by saying, so that Jesus could help us in this way. Jesus was made this way, verse 17, so that he could help us this way, verse 18. You see how wonderful that is? For because he himself has suffered when tempted, he is able to help us, to help all of those who are being tempted. Jesus was made this way so that Jesus could help us this way. This is why this verse, just this set of verses ought to bust us up. Because what it actually says to us is our need, our bloodiness, our fleshliness, our weakness, our sinfulness, our need drove Jesus to become like us, without sin, but to become like us. That's how far he came. That's how lowly he stooped. This is why you'll see this throughout Hebrews. This is why I keep geeking out about the book of Hebrews. You see the highest doctrine of Christology for the closest, nearest practical point. The deity and humanity of Jesus Christ, fully explained in doctrinal specificity for the point of helping you with the temptation that you're facing right now. It's so wonderful to receive help. It's so sad to see someone suffer and not be able to help them. Suffering in my life usually happens in the dentist's chair. And I was at the dentist this week. They checked me out and they told me, wait for it, that I didn't have any cavities this time. It was the first time in like 8 years that I've been to the dentist without having a cavity. So I'm sitting in the chair waiting for the dentist to come in. The door is open. The dentist is in the next exam room, and I can hear the poor soul whom he is examining in the next room because the door is open there and the door is open in my room. And the dentist, I recognize his voice. He's talking to the patient about pain. I heard the word root canal and several other phrases. And then when the patient started answering the dentist's questions, I was like, wait a minute. I know that guy. It was a friend of mine. I didn't know that we went to the same dentist, but it was a friend of mine in the room next to me. I recognized his voice. And the dentist is telling him that he has to have emergency root canal surgery. He said, stay in this chair. My assistant will call right now to see if we can get you in somewhere. And the dentist came in and to my room to apologize. He said, I've got a little bit of a situation over here. I'm going to have to make you wait for 5 more minutes. And I was like, doctor, I know patient, doctor privilege, but admit it to me. The person in that chair over there is so-and-so. And I said my friend's name. He was like, yeah, you know him? I'm like, yeah, he's my friend. Tell him I feel bad for him. which was true, but it was half true. If I was speaking the full truth, I would have said in all of my heart, half of my heart feels so bad for you, and half of my heart is so glad that it's you and not me. I admit that because I'm of flesh. Hebrews 2 is saying, among other things, that the sympathy and love that Jesus Christ had for us in our weakness and in our neediness drove him to become one of us, to suffer like us. Jesus is this concerned about us, this accessible to us, and this active for us. Can I underline that phrase? Hebrews 2, verses 14 to 18 shows us Jesus is this concerned about us, this accessible to us, and this active for us. He's so concerned that he left his glories above to be humbled to the point of death on a cross. He's so accessible to us because he sympathizes and understands us. And he's this active for us. Right now we can ask him for help and receive it. This is wonderful, wonderful news. The sympathy of our high priest finds its specific point of contact in our temptations and needs. The dangers that the Hebrews faced
We could summarize them in three ways. The dangers that the original recipients of this letter faced was the danger of persecution, the danger of rebellion, the danger of drift. First, the danger of persecution, that is, if they were doing the right thing, then people might persecute them and that would tempt them to let go. The second one, the danger of rebellion, that is, if they were doing the wrong thing and actively disobeying God, that's a colossal danger. And the third one, the danger of drift, that is, if they were just sort of almost not doing anything, they would drift away from an active and a vibrant faith in Jesus Christ. And Jesus is here to help us in all of these temptations and troubles. And summarize Hebrews 2 with a couple of sentences from John Murray's commentary on Hebrews 2. It's simply, listen to how much identity is here. It says, "We know that in all the temptations of life, we have a sympathizer and a helper and a comforter in the person of him from whom we can conceal nothing. This one feels with us every weakness and knows exactly what our situation is physically, morally, psychologically, and spiritually. This invests his sympathy with us with an efficacy that is nothing less than omnipotent compassion." This invests Christ's sympathy with us with a power that is nothing less than omnipotent compassion. If I could take those two words, that's almost a summary of the book of Hebrews. Omnipotent compassion. Omnipotent compassion. The full heart of Jesus sympathizes with us in compassion, but the full heart of Jesus is omnipotently able to help us in all of our suffering and in all of our need. If you want to get to the bottom of what this second point is saying, this second passage, Hebrews 2, about who Jesus is and who we are, this is what it's saying. Jesus is the one who understands and helps perfectly. Jesus is the one who understands and helps perfectly. That's what this is saying. Jesus is the one who understands and helps perfectly. Therefore, it has to include something about us, because it's not just about who Jesus is, but it's about who we are now in Jesus Christ. So Jesus is the one who understands and helps perfectly. Therefore, I am not alone. I am strengthened in my struggles. I am not alone. I am strengthened in my struggles. Do you want the assurance that you're not alone? Even when you fail, you're not alone. And do you need to be strengthened in your struggles? Are you so frustrated that you know you can't win this battle against sin? You need a strength that's not in you, a strength from outside of you that is now in you through the indwelling of the Spirit of Christ. I'm not alone. I'm strengthened in my struggles. That's the second point. And for the third, let's go to Hebrews 9, and this will bring us right to this table. Hebrews 9, verses 24 through 28. Hebrews 9, 24, "For Christ has entered, not into the holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true things, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Nor was it to offer himself repeatedly, as the high priest enters the holy places every year with blood not his own, for then he would have had to suffer repeatedly since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself." Verse 27, "And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after this comes judgment, so Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who eagerly wait for him." Here in Hebrews 9, verses 24 through 28, we find the verb to appear three times. Jesus appears, Jesus appeared, Jesus will appear. The order that these three verbs come in is the order of the argument that the author is pursuing. So the first one is in the present. Jesus is now appearing. You can see it there. The second one is in the past. Jesus appeared at the end of the ages, what he did.
And the third one is the future. He will appear again for those who are eagerly waiting his appearance. These three uses of the verb to appear summarize for us the present, the past, and the future ministry of Jesus Christ. In verse 24, talking about his present appearance, it says that he now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. That he is right now appearing in the presence of God on our behalf. That before the throne of God above, right now I have a strong and perfect plea. In the present right now, he's appearing in the presence of God on our behalf. This is marvelous. The use of the term to appear in verse 26 is about the past. It says there in verse 26, then he would have had to suffer repeatedly, but as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin. This is his appearance on the cross, that he died, and by his sacrifice on the cross, our sin was taken away. And then you see the third use of appear with a future tense in verse 28. So he will appear a second time. I love these three uses of the term to appear. When I was studying this on Monday or Tuesday this week, I diagram the passage. I just put like a little grammatical diagram on a blank white piece of paper with a blue pen, and I was so geeked out by the diagram and finding these three uses of the word to appear that I just took out my phone and I tweeted a picture of the diagram that I made of this passage. I know that most normal people, they put a picture on Facebook of their cat or of the tacos they just ordered. I just went ahead and embraced my inner geek. What I put on mine is pictures of grammatical diagrams because with these three uses of the word appear, in one little brushstroke, the author of Hebrews summarizes the eternal plan of God, all the Old Testament upcoming to Christ, what Christ did on the cross, and how he will return again, all with these three simple uses of the word appear. It's so wonderful who Jesus is explained for us. And you see it there in verse 24, who Jesus is in the present. For Christ has entered into heaven itself, verse 24, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. Christ is appearing right now in the presence of God on our behalf. It may be in the author's mind, way back from Exodus 28, the little bells on the hem of the garment. It said in Exodus 28, the priest, when he had to go into the Holy of Holies and the people couldn't see him anymore, there were bells on the fringes of his garment. Though they couldn't see him, they knew the priest was there. Where he starts here in verse 24, he says, Christ has ascended and we don't see him. But if you listen, you can hear that he is right now interceding for us in heaven. Just because you can't see him visibly doesn't mean that he can't see you and that he isn't working for you right now. He is appearing for us right now in the present, before the presence of God in heaven. So right now, Jesus is appearing for us, interceding for us, advocating for us in heaven. That's what verse 24 says. Then you look at verses 25 and 26, and it says that he has appeared. He has appeared, it says there in verse 26. But as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. This is the most straightforward understanding of what Jesus has done. He has appeared on the earth to live a perfect life in our place, to die on the cross in our place and put away our sin. Significantly, we have the phrase there that Jesus has appeared at the end of the ages. When Jesus was strung up on the cross, when Jesus died, when Jesus was put in the tomb, and when Jesus rose again, the end of the ages arrived. All of the streams of scriptural prophecy, all that came before was finally fulfilled when he died and rose again. Verses 25 and 26 are saying Jesus is the fulfillment of all the promises of redemption. Verses 25 and 26 are saying Jesus is the perfect once for all sacrifice. Verses 25 and 26 are saying Jesus died once for all in our place. And then finally, the third use of the term appear in verses 27 and 28. It says we're all going to die. Verse 27 says we're all going to die. But verse 28 says, Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. It talks about Jesus' appearance in the future. And I love this. If you could get this, it would change the way you think about your life. It says Jesus appeared at the end of the ages. It says in Hebrews 1, it says again here in Hebrews 9, that the death and resurrection of Jesus has ushered in the last days. So because Jesus has come, these prophecies are beginning to be fulfilled in all their fullness in Jesus Christ. We have a new understanding of what time it is. And we have a new understanding of what we're waiting for next. Jesus refers, whenever he's talking in the Gospels, to this age and the age to come. Because the Bible tells this massive story that's both a tragedy and a comedy. The Bible tells this massive story that God created a wonderful, perfect world where there was no sin and no death. And God is going to recreate a perfect world in which there's no sin and no death. But in this age, because of sin, there is suffering and sorrow and death. This age is the present evil age that's almost defined by sin and death and misery. But what happened when Jesus came is what Adam failed to do, Jesus did. And what happened when Jesus came was in this age where we suffer and sin and die, in this age, one of us, the best of us, Jesus Christ, God in human flesh, lived without sin and died to kill death. And the new age where there is no death and no sin, the new age broke through when Jesus walked out of the tomb. All of us and the suffering and the sinning that we go through, it's all subnormal. It's not the way that it's meant to be. But in Jesus Christ, what Hebrews is saying is that if you look to Christ, how many times does Hebrews say, look to Christ? The reason why is because if you look to Christ, if you look to Christ, you will finally see who you will be when you're no longer subnormal and fallen and failing and sinning. As he is now, so we will be when we see him. Jesus gives us a whole new understanding of what time it is, a whole new understanding of our humanity. And note well the description of the people Jesus is coming back for. Did you see it in verse 28? He will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save. Who is it that he will save? See it in verse 28. Not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly waiting for him. This is a synonym for belief. So this morning, instead of asking you, have you believed in Jesus Christ unto salvation? This morning, in the phrase of this verse, I would say to you, are you right now eagerly waiting to see Jesus? If you are, that's evidence of your salvation. That's welcome to this table. If you have no thought of Jesus appearing for you, that's evidence that your faith is weak or possibly even not there at all. How eager are you? Are you eagerly waiting for him? So this third point from Hebrews 9 can simply be summarized: Jesus is the one who has done it all, past, present, and future. Jesus is the one who has done it all, past, present, and future. That's who Jesus is. Jesus is the one who's done it all, past, present, and future. So what that says about me, I am eagerly waiting for him. I am eagerly waiting for him. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, words fail to describe how you have done it all, past, present, and future. Jesus, what you have accomplished for us, the length that you spanned to come down and rescue us, we can't possibly comprehend, but we can worship, we can wonder, we can have our affections redoubled and stirred anew because of who you are and what you've done for us. And so, Lord Jesus, in this moment, as we approach this table, help us to see you. Help us to eat and to drink your body, your blood. And in so doing, help us, Lord Jesus, help us to eagerly await your appearing again. Jesus, feed your children at your table. Amen. Amen. I invite all those who are gathered to stand with me for the benediction. Jesus Christ is the radiance of the glory of God and the exact imprint of his nature. And Jesus Christ upholds the universe by the word of his power. After making purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. Jesus Christ in his body and blood has made purification for our sin. And Jesus Christ, in all of his glory, is seated at the right hand of the Majesty on high. Amen.